across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Brightlow.
On this Thursday, January 18th, 2024, nice to have you along. Brittany Merlot will join us from the Wausau area in a bit. Kristin Lyerly in Green Bay. And what's your face over there, Greg Bach?
What's your face over there, Greg Bach?
My name is the man who's in control of this show right now. Doctor, the man who's in control of this show right now.
One button and we're off, right?
Such a snowflake. Okay, we're turning to whether there are more snowflakes in the forecast and definitely some cold temperatures. A lot of folks below zero this morning, 15 below right now in Park Falls, 5 below here at Lake Wissota, 13 below in Hayward. Brittany, you were kind of teasing us that some 30s and 40s aren't too far away, but we got to go through some stuff before we get there.
Yes, of course. Okay. We sure do. So right now, yeah, temperatures are still a little frigid out there. We went through the worst of it already, but we are going to see a little cold snap one or two more times before we do truly get into those warmer temperatures. So right now we are going to see temperatures right around zero, if not further below. We'll eventually climb to the teens today, and the winds will be calmer to start. So we're actually going to feel a lot warmer, feel more like the teens. But then as we go through tonight, those winds start to whip. We've got a quick system shooting here towards southern Wisconsin, and it is going to bring some snowflakes our way. Nothing major, nothing heavy, but we are looking at a trace potentially as far north as Green Bay and the Fox Valley to potentially 1 to 2 inches down in towards Richland Center, maybe in towards Waukesha as well, Racine too. So the further south you are in the state, the higher totals you get, closer to 2 to 3 inches. But the further north into the central part, you'll probably just see a trace out there. So this starts to push in after 4 p.m. towards La Crosse. You'll start to see some snowflakes flying around. Then it'll start to move its way by 7 o'clock in towards Kenosha area. So it'll start to wind down on the western portions of the state, not until about 7, and then on the eastern portions of the state around 10 to 11 o'clock at night, maybe a few flurries still lingering through tomorrow morning. But what's going to happen behind that snow is the winds are going to start to whip to 25 miles per hour again, pulling in the cold air once again behind it, and the skies are going to clear too. So for areas further south and west into the state, like La Crosse, Richland Center, even into the Dells, you're going to see wind chill advisories go out from 3 a.m. overnight tonight through 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. Again, it could be feeling anywhere from 20 below to near 25 below through tomorrow morning. So after that, we'll warm things up a little bit. We've got a few more cold snaps, but next week still looking like 20s, 30s, potentially 40s. Into portions of Wisconsin. So rain headed our way, an ice storm targeting some areas. We'll keep an eye on that for next week, but an active week next week.
You're trying so hard to give us as good as, hey, 30s, maybe a 40, but it's the middle of the week, and by that time it might be an ice storm. So
exactly.
Yeah, you know, don't raise the bar too high on your expectations. It's winter in Wisconsin, I guess.
That's absolutely.
That's our lesson there. All right, Brittany, thank you so much. Have a wonderful day.
You too.
All right. Did I get through all the rest of the temperatures here? We've got Oshkosh at 6 above, Madison 2, Waukesha 5 above right now, minus 2 in Wausau, 1 in Green Bay, 4 in La Crosse. Lou Regani presents an infinitely eclectic show that you can savor with song sets and illuminating collaborations of hand-selected playlists from the great universe of recorded sound. You can listen to Lou's show live 6 to noon Sunday mornings all across the Civic Media Radio Network. We were talking with Joe Zepecki earlier, Kristin, and now we want to kind of follow up on that conversation with you as well, dealing with the issue of Medicaid, known as Badger Care here in Wisconsin. We've talked quite a bit for years and years and years about Wisconsin Republicans not accepting all of the new federal money that would come by expanding Badger Care and providing health care coverage and security to more families. That's at a general level of expanding Medicaid. But there's a very targeted specific way to increase Medicaid coverage that could really make a difference in many people's lives. And Wisconsin Republicans aren't doing that either, but maybe they could do at least that little bit. Tell us about expanding Medicaid for postpartum coverage.
Well, many Republicans do want to expand postpartum Medicaid coverage. So I'm so glad that you differentiated between the two, between expanding Medicaid in general, which would provide nearly 100,000 Wisconsinites with coverage, insurance coverage, and it would save the state money. It's a win-win, but it's a political battle, and it's something that we know we can't achieve right now. But one thing we can do is take a little piece of it, postpartum Medicaid coverage. Can we extend that for a year? Right now, women, after they deliver babies, half of the women in Wisconsin lose their insurance coverage at 2 months postpartum. In almost every other state, they've extended that coverage to 12 months, which is really how long it takes your body to recover from a pregnancy. So it makes sense. But we are in the not so great category of not having done that, along with Iowa, Arkansas, and Idaho. This is something that we can do. We got the support in the Senate. We know that the governor will sign this bill, and we know that we have the support in the assembly. The barrier is getting Speaker Voss to actually introduce it and put it on the floor. If he puts it on the floor, it's likely to pass.
This is stunning to me that there are 46 states that have done this. So red states and blue states, and there's just these four laggards. And it's not the state that's a laggard. It's Assembly Speaker Robin Voss is preventing this coverage from new moms going from 60 days up to 1 year, where, like you said, not only real health concerns, but real maternal mortality issues.
Yeah. Here. Oh, yeah. So half of the women who die related to pregnancy die in the postpartum period. And we know that 80% of these deaths are preventable. So we know that we would save the lives of new moms, moms with young infants and young families, if we extended Medicaid. This is how easy it is. And there's one person in this state who is preventing this from happening.
Let's talk about the reasons why, the reasons for postpartum deaths, because they're quite varied, but all very important. Some are physical, some are mental.
Mm-hmm. A lot of them are actually mental and psychological. Postpartum depression is very, very common. We lose a lot of moms to suicide and to, unfortunately, drug overdoses. These are things that are very treatable if people can get in and get access to care. Other things, we are a sicker and sicker population, and we're getting pregnant and having babies later and later. So we're seeing more incidents of diabetes and blood pressure problems, more heart issues, more really truly medical issues that not only affect people in the pregnancy and the postpartum period, but in the long term. These are become chronic diseases for many people that require long-term care, and getting that care immediately in the postpartum period is what is going to help set these people up to live healthier lives so that they can take care of their families and be productive members of society like we all want to be.
So if Robin Voss is the one holding it up, I feel like at this point in time in 2024, after the 2023 he had, this seems like a pretty no-brainer come together bipartisan and then take a victory lap and say, we're doing this for the people of Wisconsin. We're doing this together. I don't understand what's keeping him from doing it.
Hey, I don't either. Especially knowing that we've got the support amongst the Republicans in the assembly. We have enough Republicans in the assembly who have already said, this is important. We see it. We've got the pro-life groups and the pro-choice groups agreeing that this is a priority. We've got the OBGYNs and the Catholics agreeing. We've got the March of Dimes and the American Heart Association. Over 40 groups have come together to say, this is a priority. You're right, Greg. This is a no-brainer, and it doesn't make any sense to me either.
What it underscores is the extremism that you find in politics. When you have gerrymandered maps and the most extreme folks from whichever party is in control are in control. Robin Voss, like a lot of extreme Republicans, believes in basically the ER theory, that there's no reason we need to expand this government program because, you know what, if somebody's really in that bad of shape, they'll show up at the ER and they'll get treated. We don't need, you know, to do anything different. It's such a naive and ignorant viewpoint, but it is the viewpoint that's out there among many who think, well, you know, doctors are altruistic. They'll treat anybody who walks in the door.
Which we will. We're obligated to do that because of EMTALA, which is if you show up at the emergency department, regardless of your ability to pay, if you're sick and you need treatment, we have to take care of you unless it's pregnancy related and you're in Texas. But here in Wisconsin, if you show up in the emergency department, we are going to take care of you. But that's not optimal care. And that's not the kind of care a lot of these people need. They need a relationship. They need trust. They need to know that their situations, whether they are a mental issue, a psychological issue, a physical issue, are being managed for the long term. That's care. It's more than just sticking a Band-Aid on it and saying, go away and figure it out.
So that's why there was this press event yesterday involving Protect Our Care, which Joe Zepecki is a part of, and you were one of the speakers at it, basically to say that, look, this common sense thing has already passed the Wisconsin State Senate 32-1. Mm-hmm. And that was back in October. It's been sitting in the assembly ever since. And so you're just asking people to call their assembly rep or specifically call Robin Voss's office and say, please schedule a vote on this. You don't have to be mean or nasty about it. Just show that you support this and keep building that support.
And I couldn't emphasize more. You said 32-1. Those are Republicans. Those are Democrats. This is not a partisan issue. This truly is an issue where you can make a difference by giving Robin Voss a call and just encouraging him to support moms and babies and families in Wisconsin.
Yeah, exactly. In just a little bit here at the bottom of the hour, we're going to have our Women Win Wisconsin segment, and Kristin is going to introduce us to a state assembly candidate who's a busy mom and talk about the reasons why she's decided to throw her hat in the ring. But coming up next, we're going to talk about a uniquely personal story in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, all about family ties to organized crime and the mob in Milwaukee that flourished. And talk about how, you know, something similar was happening, you know, with my family in St. Paul all those many years ago. It's an interesting time, and we'll talk about that as well. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this Thursday morning, when you're here, you're up north. We'll be back in just a bit. Again, it was on this day in 1989, Stevie Wonder became the youngest living inductee into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame at the tender age of 38. We have our daily history lesson and music break every morning at 6:50 here on Up North News Radio. Back now with Kristin Lyerly and Greg Bach, and the most fascinating story that was in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel yesterday, written by longtime investigative reporter Mary Spacuzza. The headline just grabs you. It says, "My cousin was killed by a car bomb in Milwaukee. A mob boss was the top suspect. Now I'm looking for answers." Well, you had me right there. That was the next hour of my life, was carefully reading this thing. It was just an amazing story about the killing of Augie Palmisano in a car bombing on June 30th, 1978. And as she recounts the way that her family never wanted to talk about Augie, never wanted to talk about his death, but, you know, she came to understand that he was very well regarded, you know, in their Italian neighborhood, and that at some point he must have crossed somebody. Maybe it was Frank Balestrieri, the infamous mob boss of Milwaukee. Maybe not. But the more that she dug into it, the more she came to appreciate that not every family secret, not every secret can be found if you go through enough police records and enough press clippings. There's just some things that, you know, you're never going to know that go with time. But I just thought it was just fascinating, Kristin and Greg, about being able to tell such a personal story about such an a crazy time in this country in the 1920s when you know gangland activity was flourishing.
And having grown up in the Green Bay area, I remember my parents telling stories about how the mobsters from Chicago, I had never known about the mobsters from Milwaukee, but the mobsters from Chicago would come up here and they would hang out at this place in Kakana, or what's the place up in way up north with the bullet holes still in the wall where Dillinger just barely escaped?
Oh. Or was it Al Capone? You know, it's like Al Capone stopped here. John Dillinger stopped there. Yeah. It's a wonder they got anything done. They were going to so many different places and sleeping in so many places, it appears. But they were, you know, this was the era of prohibition. And so that was the organized crime, was running, you know, running liquor, whether moonshine or otherwise, you know, to all these places. And you had corrupt cops, you had corrupt agents, you had agents who were able to infiltrate, you know, these various gangs, and Mary's story does that. Oh, thank you, Greg. Yes, the Little Bohemia Lodge in Manitowish Waters. That's it.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I just really highly recommend taking the time to read this. And even if you don't have a tie to Milwaukee, but if you do have a tie to Milwaukee, it's great to read. And I say all that having read a similar story. It was actually a small book by somebody about the mafia activities in St. Paul, where
I grew up. Yes, let's hear more about this, Pat.
I wish I knew more because
talk about the mafia, Pat. It's just
the deal was that St. Paul had one of these corrupt police chiefs back then that said to, you know, writ large to all these from Capone's gang and all these other folks, you can come to St. Paul and lay low from time to time. Don't cause any trouble in my city and we'll be good. And St. Paul was like, so when people talk about, they went to Manitowish Waters, or they went up to, we were in Regina, Canada, and there's a place where Al Capone was, reputed to have gone. But they used St. Paul as a stopping off point. And there's this hole in my family tree that I won't get too deep into, but we'd kind of like to know who this mystery person is. But the rumor was always, well, they were tied to the mob there, and there were people in our family who went to their grave not sharing some of the most intimate details of, you know, who somebody's father was, for example. And I've often thought about trying to look into it further, but as Mary's article shows us, I mean, you can dig and dig and dig, but some secrets actually still do go to the grave.
Well, we're here today, Pat, to tell you that that person was Joey Stick-a-Butt. Hey!
I love that, though, as you're talking to your family members and they're disclosing little tidbits of what they think happened, even though there's nothing to back it up. You don't really know. Like, I feel like I have a great uncle out there somewhere who was in Mexico, and there was also some sort of a car bomb and he was running from something. And I remember being a little kid listening to the story and just being captivated by it. I have no proof. I have no idea what it all means, but that's part of the family lore.
And those 23andMe and Ancestry.com have kind of killed those old family stories. Like, but also it's kind of weird because, like, my cousin was doing some research on Ancestry.com and she said, I didn't know your grandfather was in World War II. And I'm like, he wasn't. In fact, he probably would have done everything to not be in World War II. His brother was. My grandpa ran liquor for the mob back in the 30s. And so he's not going to the army.
So Greg is clearly attached to this story as well.
I love it. I love this stuff. I love the Milwaukee's little mafia here. And then I guess in Madison, it was like two guys.
Classic.
Yeah, of course. When I had an older relative who has long since passed away, a second cousin, but who introduced me to a whole lot of Kreitlow family history that I didn't know. He had done the research, and again, it didn't fill in all of the blanks, but he told this story as well, as he traced our family back to Germany. It was kind of in that area where the border between Germany and Poland kind of went back and forth over time. So we're German and Polish at the same time. Anyway, as he had some time back, this had to be 30, 40 years ago, was able to finally go to Germany and find some Kreitlows over there. And he talked about how during the war, he served in World War II, and he served in North Africa trying to repel, you know, the Nazi invasion of North Africa. And suddenly some of these other Kreitlows, you know, grew kind of quiet. And then it came out that, like, their ancestor, their great grandfather or grandfather, whoever it was fighting for the Germans in North Africa and was killed by American troops. So you literally had, you know, Kreitlows trying to kill other Kreitlows on the battlefields of World War II. So these stories I just find so fascinating. And the whole notion of using 23andMe or Ancestry to fill in the blanks, I always have to laugh because my dad, God bless him, you know, he passed several years ago now, but when all that was new, he took one of these tests. He was looking to maybe fill in some of these blanks, and it was relatively new at the time. So the answer that he got back was basically a map of the world and a dot over all of Europe that says you probably came from here. Well, Same. Gosh, thanks for ruling out India, you know, or whatever. Well, I took one last year, and the dot was actually quite smaller and properly placed over that area, you know, in northern Germany, you know, Poland, places like that. But again, I looked at the names that came back, and I didn't recognize a lot of the names. So at some point, I'm going to start reaching out to these folks, and maybe we'll be able to fill things in. But we've all heard those kind of those weird twists in those 23andMe stories where you realize, oh, you know, dad's not my dad. The next door neighbor is my dad. Yeah. You know, you kind of wonder what more can you learn from these stories?
And a fun website to go to that's totally legit and taught me a little bit about my family, findagrave.com.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It showed me where part of my family came from, Poland. I didn't know it until findagrave.com.
So we could be cousins.
Yes, we could, Pat. The Kreitlows come together and celebrate family. I don't know, Kristin, why I went from one to the other.
Who are we? Who are we meeting after the break here, Kristin?
Thank you for just making a break from this conversation. We're talking to Sarah Keyeski. Sarah is running for state assembly over on the western part of Wisconsin, the 42nd Assembly District. So super excited to be spending some time with her this morning.
That's coming up next. You're up north. Noting the anniversary of the birth of Eddie Ruffin from, or David Ruffin, rather, from the Temptations. Back now at just about 7:35, time for our weekly Women Win Wisconsin segment with Dr. Lyerly as we look at meeting women all around the state who are trying to make a difference in their communities and maybe make a difference on new levels as well, Kristin.
Yeah, we are so excited this morning to welcome Sarah Keyeski, who is already declared and running for state assembly in District 42. Sarah, welcome to Women Win Wisconsin this morning.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me and having a platform like this.
So we want to hear all about you. Who are you and why did you decide to run?
Okay, well, let me give you a little bit of background. I'm a mental health therapist, and I've been doing this for over 25 years. But part of my sort of heart is about community. And so during COVID, when things got really difficult, I started a nonprofit, and it was oriented all about uplifting our community. From that, I got to know different people, and they asked me to run. And so that was not really on my docket. That wasn't anything that I had ever thought about before. But they sort of saw things in me that now I get to see in myself and a potential of being able to do more than I've ever been able to do just one-on-one in my therapy office, which is this. And so I am now running to be able to do meaningful things in situation that is much bigger than for one.
So for you, this hasn't been, I want to be in the assembly. Mm-hmm. It's more, I see a problem in the world and I want to fix it. And you created this nonprofit and now you find yourself in this situation where you can be part of the solution from a place that you really never thought you could be before. Is that right?
Exactly. Yeah, I had never aspired to any kind of political office, anything big like that. I've always been sort of very heart oriented in like helping people one on one, hands on, you know, therapeutically. But when, you know, really, I see our world struggling so much with a mental health crisis. I think that's become clearer and clearer. And now my sort of mission, I guess, is to figure out how can I, instead of just helping people cope with what is difficult in the world, some of the policies and some of the social ills, instead of coping with them, I want to be in a position where I can maybe help fix them. And so that's my goal now, is to just try to expand my service area, if you will, and maybe do a little bit more to help more people and to make our system better.
So in terms of helping more people then from a legislative, you know, policy standpoint, obviously for me, the first thing that comes to mind would be, you know, expanding Medicaid coverage. Is that kind of paramount to your platform as well? Or are there other things you think that the legislature could be doing to do more for mental health care and other care for people around the state?
Yeah, it's a great question. That's a huge one, right? We really need to have access for as many people as possible, and preferably all people, to have access to both really good physical or medical care and mental health care. But there's also many social determinants of mental health. So while I hear a lot, and I appreciate this, that there's an awareness of mental health needs and a desire to help more people by getting access and affordability for mental health care, I'd like to roll it back a little bit further and say, okay, what are the social determinants that are impacting us to be struggling in this kind of way? And how can we address those? So poverty is a huge one. The access to medical care is a huge one. Having good educational systems for all kids is a big issue for me. Child care is important. So there's so many things that really kind of feed into, and of course, I will not be remiss to not say I believe in the freedom of reproductive choice, because if we are requiring people to do something as to me cruel as having them carry an unviable fetus, the level of trauma we are creating for that person, or let's say we are these women are passing away because of this, then we have children that now have the loss and the trauma. So we have to understand this is just a huge like ripple effect. And if we want to do better in our society, we need to address these bigger issues, not just one-on-one and having everybody get a counselor, which would be lovely, but we need to do bigger.
As somebody who has studied public health and recognizes all of those social determinants that you were just talking about, we know in this state, in this country right now, our mental health has probably never been worse, especially in young people. And this clearly is an area of expertise for you. And you recognize how all of those other things tie in to mental health. Are there specific things that you are intending to focus on in your campaign that you've been hearing from people as you've been talking about how you intend to make this change in Wisconsin?
Well, I think people are wanting to understand why we're struggling as much. And while I don't have any particular answers, I think a significant part is that the world is moving really fast. And we're trying to catch up and be able to manage the demands in a society that is highly stressful. And so part of my goal is try to help people gain, I guess, more emotional maturity and awareness and understanding so that we can teach that to our children. But also understanding what do we need to do differently in a society that is changing so much, so that we can have a better balance, for example, for our well-being versus having such a capitalistic driven system where I think we get lost in the connectedness to community, the connectedness to outdoors. And so my sense is that we need to kind of change things in ways that we yet are learning and needing to understand, that we need to have a new perspective on and hopefully be open-minded to thinking about differently.
Can we get into the other parts of your website that describe you? Because we've talked about counselor, obviously, but there's also farmer's daughter and parent of six. So where do we start on that? Let's hear more about your farm background.
Oh, sure. So I grew up in Cashton, Wisconsin, one of five kids, and we lived on a farm just on the ridge. It was called Fish Creek Ridge. I grew up there all from the age of, I think I was eight. We moved there when I was eight, and then obviously until I left for college. And so I learned a really good ethic of hard work, because anybody that knows rural life and having a farm, you know about picking rocks, and you know about doing raking hay and unloading hay bales from the wagon. So I learned a lot of good ethical things there, and the tightness of family and community. And then I went off to study. I went and got a couple of degrees. I have a master's degree in psychology. But ultimately, I wanted to raise my family in a small community again because of what I had gained. I thought I would be a big city girl. Turns out I'm actually a small town girl. And so I returned to small roots. And so I moved to Lodi. And I've continued to be a mental health therapist with my blended family of six kids. And so we are loving our town. And I've opened a practice here. So this is my private practice in Lodi because I believe in affordable, accessible mental health services. So in my small town of about 3,000 people, I opened a practice and trying to give back again to my community. So I guess that's a little bit about me. And then again, just believing in being a participant in our community.
But what I have to know is, as somebody who married into a family just like what you describe here, to what degree do you threaten those six kids with having to go pick rock if they don't shape up? Because that was a pretty universal punishment we wielded. Never really had to execute, but they always knew it was out there.
Yeah, you know, they don't really understand. And so I'm like, how do I give you a real life experience of this, right? Mm-hmm. And so I constantly am telling them stories about my childhood, and they're, you know, a little bit like indifferent. And they're like, I get it, you know, like you had a hard life. I'm like, no, I didn't have a hard life. I had a really good life. It was enriched. But you don't understand work in the same way. But, you know, it's also taught me how to teach them. Because one of my parenting philosophies is really making sure that they're very responsible. They have chores. They are contributing. I don't pay for everything that if they want to have anything, they have to earn it. So it's, you know, it's sort of that ethic that I could still take into this era, even though the kids have a different experience.
Hey, and when you run for office, your whole family runs for office with you.
Yeah.
I'm curious to know what your family thinks about this big step that you've decided to take.
Well, originally, yeah, I had to kind of cover it with them and make sure they were on board. And I will say at first, my husband was really hesitant because, you know, we hear about kind of the dangers of political people and some of the vitriolic responses they get from people. So he was really worried about my safety. I'm kind of a, you know, I think I just have a grittiness to me. And I'm just kind of bold. While also trying to be really kind. But I really just believe in what I believe in, and I have a strong like backbone about it. And so when we talked about it, he goes, well, yeah, I guess I have known you for really, you know, almost 20 years. And so I do believe you can do it, and you probably won't wilt. So he knows I can manage it. And so that was lovely. And then my kids, I think they were, at first it was really cute. My daughter, she was wondering like, well, will I ever be home? And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'll be home every night. Okay, well, then if we get to be with you. And so, yeah, and then they've just been, I mean, really remarkably supportive. And then my son last night told me that he was in learning in class about gerrymandering, and he was all excited to talk to me about it. And he goes, will that affect you, Mom? And I'm like, oh, yes, let me tell you about it. Yeah, so we're all learning a lot as a family. It's really quite cute.
Well, that's the thing is that, you know, we talk about you being in the 42nd Assembly District right now, but in just a few weeks, everybody's going to be, you know, maybe in something different, and you're going to have to be prepared to go with the flow on this, shall we say, and maybe that part of town that you thought was in the district is now over here instead. So you're kind of prepared to be rather nimble.
Exactly, right. Flexibility and being able to pivot. The good news is that is fine with me. I didn't have a big sense of this, again, beforehand, so a big plan about, like, where and what. It's really been like, okay, where am I needed? Where, you know, what can I do? Who can I help? How can I do that best? And being open-minded to kind of having some of the political gurus share with me. But also, it's been really important for me to make sure that I stay really true to who I am, because I'm not a political person. So there's sort of this nuance of, like, I want to know, but I just don't really want to kind of go too far into that, because it's not really who I am. I don't have, like, the stump speech kind of thing. I know I need to learn it a little bit, but I just really want to just be me. And if that is, you know, captivating or compelling to people, great, because this is what you get. This is who I am and who I've always been. And if it's not quite your thing and you'd like somebody a bit more stoic and polished, I guess that, you know, will be an option too. But hopefully they'll see my heart and my commitment.
Hey, and I'd really like to invite our listeners to check out your social media, your Facebook page, your threads and Instagram, because you are a constant poster and the things that you're posting are uplifting and delightful. And they really show a genuine desire to be part of the solution. There are a lot of strategies behind politics. What are the numbers in my district? And can I win this? And that is not the approach that you're taking. The approach that you seem to be taking is, I just want to be part of the solution. I want to fix things and I want to help out my community.
Yeah, I think that's my strongest, you know, I'm always about solution seeking with my clients, right? I mean, we can talk about what's wrong, but it's not helpful to sit in that. I want to empathize with that, but then where's our accountability to do more? And so for me, it's a civic obligation to do more in my society too, in my community. That's why I did the nonprofit, is to really give back. And so it's just, you know, I grew up with that. I grew up with mission trips. I grew up with doing volunteerism. And so it's just part of who I am. And so it's a very natural part. And I just continue that because to me, this is public service. And so it's another branch of that, really, in a way that hopefully is I'm capable to do really well.
Clearly so. And so again, folks can go to Keyeski for Wisconsin, K-E-Y-E-S-K-I. Also look for her on Facebook and on Threads and on Instagram. Sarah, so great to meet you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Pat and Dr. Lyerly. Thank you so much for the time.
All right. Luke Mathers, after this, you're up north. How great would it be if Greg and Luke and I had figured out, you know, to do the whole thing in sync here just to surprise Kristin, like we're actual background singers. We're Pips.
Wrong band.
Kristin can be our Gladys Knight.
I got you. Let's go, baby. Come on.
So, speaking of rhythm, Luke Mathers joins us now. The man whose dancing shoes saved an entire company Christmas party joins us now. So.
The very capable, the very handsome,
oh, that's
strong.
Right. Yes,
he can lift a car with his one hand.
No, that would have meant that I didn't get stuck in the Waukesha studio parking lot on my way home from the blizzard on Friday because...
Oh, no. See?
You...
What?
Luke, you
I
didn't
told
get stuck.
You.
Winter wanted you to wait.
It was a brief being stuck, but I have the terrible, terrible habit of pulling, like, when you're in a parking, two parking spaces, I like to pull through and then just go out that way rather than back out and then go around the long way. I don't know. It's just a terrible habit, and I went over the slush and ice that... Jane's car had left, and so I kind of got trapped.
Oh, it's Jane's fault.
So it's Jane's fault.
No. Uh-huh. It was not Jane's fault.
You heard it here, folks.
But I went through the slush that Jane's car had, and it's my fault for being an idiot thinking that my car could manage that. So you Calvin know, had to come out for a little bit. We were having some fun, and then after 5-10 minutes, I was free.
You know what you needed was a little Jordan Love.
Yeah, yes, I did not have that. Him available to me, like the very lucky Green Bay Packer resident that was able to have a hand like that. But I did have producer Calvin, which, you know, almost the equivalent.
Well, Jordan didn't actually get the girl out of the ditch. He helped.
But, and Calvin didn't actually get me out of the parking lot either, but he helped.
He helped. There we go. Hey, as we get into what we can find on civic media here, I noticed at 6:30 and 7:30, we have a new daily report from Pam Yonke, who has a 5 a.m. show across much of civic media, but she now gives us updates on farm markets and ag news that impacts the rural economies across Wisconsin at 6:30, 7:30. And now I see here it's also going to be 12:30, 2:30, and 3:30. So welcome, Pam, to her new presence several times a day across the Civic Media Radio Network.
Pam.
And poor Pat is so worried about being left out that he's been told something that he's like, wait, I heard something new. I need to ask. Am I supposed to be hearing this? Is this? And it was a soft launch, Pat. It was. We wanted to make sure that we knew everything was in place so that it was playing out properly before we were, you know, letting everybody know. But
see, I just wanted to be a team player and promote, you know, this right away. And I figured maybe since I didn't get one of those notes from, you know, you about, you know, shows that we need to promote, that maybe somebody had dropped the ball. But there you are doing launch.
Everybody pack your bags. Pat's taking us on a guilt trip.
Team player and trust issues. They sound very similar, Pat.
Why is it that my guilt trips always get stuck in the ditch as well? Oh, well.
Oh, boy.
You want to tell us any new things? Cripes Cast or other weekend or day or evening appearances? Otherwise, I've got this Lou Regani promo that I can rattle off as well.
That's where we're going. So that's this week's show spotlight. Going, if you're a fan of big band music and you're a fan of some would say a bygone era, but definitely still around when it comes to that type of music, Lou Regani will take you on a trip from 7 a.m. until noon every Sunday across the Civic Media Network. 7 a.m. 7 a.m.
It's 6 in those notes that Luke Mather sent me.
Got so updated, maybe you're looking at an old version.
Maybe I'm looking at the
boys.
Version he sent. I don't know.
Welcome to our family squabble, everyone.
Yes. So 7 to noon on Sunday mornings, you say?
7 to noon Sunday mornings across the Civic Media Network. Join Lou Regani for Music of the Stars.
Lou Regani. This is Lou Regani. How you doing, everybody?
That does kind of sound like a mafia name too, doesn't it?
I did really enjoy listening to some big band and related music last night, prepping for tomorrow's show in Waukesha. So I was listening to a bunch of Les Paul and Mary Ford tunes. And so we've got one or two of those that we're going to hear tomorrow, because you can't go to Waukesha and not do some kind of paying homage to Les Paul. Yeah. I mean, it's in one of the liners here. What do you guys say down there on the Shaw from Les Paul Parkway to the interstate?
Whether you're stuck in traffic on Les Paul Parkway or on 94.
Which you never are. Yeah. I mean, but I love Les Paul. I got to see him. I saw him in 2007 in New York.
Really?
Yeah. I can talk about that tomorrow. And I got to meet him. I'll talk about that tomorrow. But yes, Les Paul. My grandpa went to school with him for 1 year.
Oh.
Whoa.
Yeah. I mean, you read everything that he did in terms of, you know, he didn't invent the electric guitar, but he sure as hell did everything but, you know, in terms of perfecting it and making it sing. And so I'm watching these old videos and realizing, you know, it's like if Eddie Van Halen had been dropped into the 1950s, that's the kind of music he would have done with those same guitar licks. Just an amazing talent.
He's in the Inventors Hall of Fame.
I would love to hear some stories from Waukesha natives who knew Les Paul, like your dad.
They're
Greg.
All dead.
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus. Wow. No, my dad
took a dark turn.
Well, Les Paul, my grandpa went to school with it, not my dad. Les Paul would be like 105 right now.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I'm sure there's lore out there, you know? People know people who knew Les Paul.
Okay,
well, stories.
Tomorrow.
Oh, here we go.
Listeners, if you live in Waukesha or you have any Les Paul stories, call in tomorrow and let's hear some.
There you go.
Absolute lies.
No. We don't want that.
Greg's I'm not going to fact check any of the phone calls. You just call me up. Let me know something great. Yeah. Tell me a good story.
Yeah.
Well, there went tomorrow's show. That's going to be a lot of fun. I haven't done a live show elsewhere for a while since I did, I think Oshkosh was the last one I did. So it's going to be great to see the studio in Waukesha and, you know, get more of us on the road throughout 2024 and have fun across the civic media landscape. We've had Todd Alba up here in Chippewa Falls a couple of times. Luke, you were last in Green Bay a month ago or so, something like that.
That sounds about right. Time's a weird instance. But as soon as the roads start to thaw out, I will be hitting the road more and more. So it's going to be great for show hosts to be able to do that as well.
And some of their regulars.
Call me? What?
It was a very quick trip of me underneath the studio.
You were not in town.
Sure, the right kids wires were connected.
Kids, get your organs.
Well, we hope you enjoyed today's makeup. Hope you enjoyed today's guilt trips. We'll be doing this again tomorrow from our beautiful studios in Waukesha. Thanks, you guys. Have a wonderful day.
You too, Pat. You too. Safe travels.
Yep. To all of you as well. Enjoy your day. Be careful out there for the little light snow that's going to be falling in many places, and bundle up. It's going to be cold for another couple of ones as well before we get that warm up. Keep it here across the Civic Media Radio Network, and we'll join you from Waukesha tomorrow morning at 6.